neither of these explosions are actually real. This one, known as a physical or special effect, happened on set and is much more colorful than in reality. And this one, a computer animation, was created using an algorithm. So what are we technically seeing on screen?
We have to create these effects that people have come to think of as explosions that really aren't explosions at all. They're fire reactions. The real explosion takes place very quickly because you have energy moving over 20,000 feet per second. So 1 minute the car is there, then the next minute there's nothing. Movie version explosion happens thousands of times slower, always involves fire, always involves smoke.
Steve Wolf has developed and executed stunts like these and hundreds more for over 30 years on film and television sets. There are two ways explosions release energy, by deflagration and detonation. The explosions Steve usually creates are deflagrations. They produce pressure waves that travel slower than the speed of sound, which makes them subsonic. They are easier to control, like these chemical reactions with powder. Supersonic explosions release by detonation. These pressure waves, which travel faster than the speed of sound, are created by high explosives like C4.
So sometimes I want a lot of flame, sometimes I want something to physically move, so we have to choose the materials that we're going to use to create that effect. Most of the time, high explosives are not going to be the answer.
To control the fire and the effect, Steve removes everything from the site of the explosion. In this case, the interior of a test car.
The only thing that's burning are the fuels that we put in there, so we can control exactly the quantity of the fuel, the nature of the fuel, what reactions are going to take place inside the vehicle, and make sure that there's nothing else involved. We want to use the least amount of kinetic energy that's necessary to create the effect. So we pre-cut the car. We cut the hinges on the doors and just hot melt them back on, and the same thing with the hood, so that just a small amount of energy will make the car fall apart.
This method of special effects is still popular with filmmakers because it is relatively inexpensive and easily repeatable. Now compare it to this, a computer animation. Traditionally, effects like these have been complex and costly, taking days or weeks to render over multiple machines. By researching complex natural phenomena, Dr. Theodore Kim has been able to drastically improve this process over the last few decades.
Complex natural phenomena is a nonlinear phenomena. Basically, almost all of what you see in the natural world is nonlinear, because most things don't just travel in a straight line. And if it doesn't travel in a straight line, then the math that you learn in high school, it doesn't quite get the job done. So you're gonna have to start using something a little bit more advanced, and that's where we come in. A big breakthrough in fluid simulation was by a Canadian researcher named Yost Stam back in 1999. It enabled artists to manipulate a fluid simulation in real time. So something like smoke rising from a cigarette, or steam from a coffee cup, something like that. One of the limitations of this method, though, was that the fluid that it produced looked very viscous. So you could get very large, very broad swirls out of it. But the thing that makes, for example, large explosions look like large explosions is that there's lots of tiny little curls that then spin off from the main explosion. It didn't quite excel at generating those specific details.
Theodore answers this in his paper called Wavelet Turbulence. He combined Stamp's algorithm with a modified version of a pre-existing formula that quickly generated those tiny swirls. But the details weren't quite moving with the laws of physics.
So any fluid simulation, you have to use velocity and you have to use pressure. In some form, what we did is we added small-scale noise or high-frequency noise.
Theodore used a tool called Wavelet Transform, which could detect when and where tiny details appeared off.
It uses something called texture detection. First, we detect where would some small swirl have actually appeared. So we go ahead and inject the swirl and have it move along with the existing flow. Advection just means the velocity is pulling something along. So a leaf, for example, is advected in a stream. It's just been pulled along by the stream. We then have to analyze the Jacobian of the texture coordinate, because what can happen, as with any flow, it can try to pull something apart or it can try to push it back together. So we detect when that happens and then we delete that vortex. So it's not allowed to exist anymore.
By building and perfecting this algorithm, Theodore could synthesize all these details quickly so that artists could get the look they wanted for explosions in fast enough time. The tool was so effective and featured in so many movies that it earned Theodore an Academy Award.
My favorite one was probably Super 8. There's a big train sequence at the beginning, and it was used for a lot of the fire effects for the train crash. Mechanical engineering is usually not concerned with artistic purposes, so while we use much of the similar underlying math, we do tweak it in our own way to make it so that it's artistically controllable.
There's really just a handful of laws of physics that control how everything works. Whether we do something amazing with it or not is just by how we take those simple concepts and how we put them together.
This episode was presented by the U.S. Air Force. Learn more at airforce.com. For more episodes of Science in the Extremes, check out this one right here. Don't forget to subscribe and come back to Seeker for more episodes. Thanks for watching.